Welcome to Talks at Goldman Sachs. I'm Asahi Pompei. I serve as President of the Goldman Sachs Foundation and Global Head of Corporate Engagement. I am honored to be joined by philanthropic icon, Darren Walker. Darren is President of the Ford Foundation, where he manages over $600 million in annual grant giving. Darren, let's start with your early beginnings. So you were born in Charity Hospital in Lafayette, Louisiana. You were raised by a single mother in Ames, and then you moved on to Baytown, Texas. Tell us a bit about your mother and how she shaped your early life.
Well, thank you. I probably, like many of you, I have an amazing mother who has been a source of inspiration for me, in part because she's enormously resilient. I think my mother, who is now 84 and somewhere on a cruise to Alaska, lives a life that she, growing up poor in rural Louisiana, could never have imagined. And I think, like most parents, she had dreams for me. My mother didn't necessarily have the knowledge to say, oh, you should be a humanities major, or you should take the classics, or you need to know Latin, or any such thing. But she did really engender in me a thirst for knowledge. And also, I think it's fair to say I was an odd little boy. And I think that was fine with her. And I think that also contributed to my own confidence and my own comfort with my being a queer little boy and certainly an oddity in rural East Texas. And then in 1965, we were living in Ames, Texas, and this population 800. This dirt road, and we lived in this neat little shotgun shack, and a lady approached the porch, and she told my mother about a new program that was starting that summer, and it was called Head Start, and they were going to roll out the program in 1965 in the summer, and she wanted to enroll the people, young people ages 5 to 7 who were in the community. And so I was lucky enough to be in the first class of Head Start in 1965. And it really, I think, started me on my journey for learning and reading and all the things that I think, were foundational. So I was really lucky. I was very, very lucky, even though to most people, I think, by probably today's standards, and if a sociologist were to sort of look at it, would probably not think it was an enabling environment, if you will. But I learned a lot.
So you went on to University of Texas, and of those years, a recent profile said Darren thrived both academically and socially. You went on after University of Texas, you went to law school there as well, and you spent a decade as an attorney and then at UBS in capital markets. You've said that for individuals that are interested in working in philanthropy, and you mentioned inequality in particular, you think it's important to actually start in the private sector. Tell us more about what you learned during those early years.
Well, I am a big believer in working in the private sector whenever. I mean, I'm a capitalist. I think that, it's a very good thing to have our markets working. I don't think our markets are working for enough people, by the way, but I think the notion that one begins a career in a law firm, an investment bank, whatever, I think is great. And I learned at Cleary, I learned so much because I had a great partner who I worked for who just taught me so much. I learned how to manage time. I learned how to manage multiple matters for clients and helping making every client think that they are your first priority. I understood how to manage a P&L. I mean, all the things that You learn.
Yeah.
And the discipline that comes from that. And all of that really benefited me. I mean, the thing that made it possible for me when I finally did transition to Abyssinia and to work in Harlem was I found, I understood project finance. I just had never done it for like low-income housing. And so because that was the core work of the organization, where I was COO and headed all the real estate development, it just, it was a perfect alignment. And so it was really great. I felt like the skills that I had learned and that I had, you know, used, you know, working for UBS or Salomon or Prudential or whoever the client was completely adaptable and transferable to something that was really, for me, far more socially, spiritually, emotionally gratifying.
After leadership roles at Abyssinian and Rockefeller, you joined the Ford Foundation, and then you became president in 2013. Your leadership of the Ford Foundation has really been marked around inequality and tackling this problem of inequality in our country. Can you talk a bit more about that?
Well, sure, it relates to the first pillar of our mission, strengthening democracy. Growing inequality in a society like the United States is a threat to democracy. I mean, because at the center of the American narrative is the idea of hope, aspiration, and mobility. The idea that you can start with nothing, that stories like mine are not so uncommon. And I think one of the reasons my story resonates with people, some people, is that it is a story of hope and aspiration and hard work and a lot of luck. But the kind of narrative that could only happen in this country. And people that resonates with people, with people in this country, because it affirms the idea of America.
Yes.
Right? So we want that idea to be affirmed. But inequality actually asphyxiates that idea because it's not possible to live in a society with hope when increasing numbers of people don't actually have an opportunity to move up. I mean, so again, not to get technical, but when you talk to economists and you just look at longitudinal data for people like me who, you know, born in, you know, the top bottom decile, absolutely. My story is unusual. So you're born in the bottom decile and you end up in the top 1%. All right. But you're born in the bottom quarter and you end up in the top quarter. Right, so how many people make that move up the mobility escalator like that? Fewer people are. We know that's a fact. That's not like political. That's not. This is a fact. No economist is going to. It's incontrovertible. The data are there. That's a problem for democracy. And so when we hear things and we see things like how these sort of signatures that then amplify a larger message, like the selling of seats at prestigious universities to rich people. I mean, those are horrible, horrible interventions in our society because it sends a message to that working family in Ohio who has aspirations for their kid to go to Stanford or Harvard that they shouldn't even try because the kids who are at Dalton and you know, live on Park Avenue, and I mean, those are the kids who are going to be going to those schools because their parents, the system is rigged. And when people, and again, the data's out there, increasing numbers of Americans believe our systems are rigged. And when they believe our systems are rigged, they become cynical and they become hopeless. And if you have, like I do, travel much of the world, particularly in the developing world, in the global South, one of the real challenges is the sort of cynical way people view their government, their institutions, rich people. I mean, the response of rich people. We shouldn't be surprised by what we see in America today in terms of inequality. Our system has been designed to deliver it. Every system, and again, this isn't a political statement. Our criminal justice system was designed to get us the outcomes that we have, which is that most poor black and brown men and poor whites increasingly, and women, you know, who are ensnared in the justice system, you know, end up in prison or on parole for long periods of time. We had a war on drugs that was, if you read, you know, the original memo from, you know, Ehrlichman to Richard Nixon, it was designed targeting Negroes and hippies, two of the enemies of the Nixon administration. And so, you know, arrest them for marijuana, arrest them for loitering, arrest them, but criminalize them. And so, you know, we shouldn't be surprised. And this, and our economic system, same thing. I mean, you know, we designed, some people would like to argue that, well, this is all natural. This is natural. This is, you know, I'll say something that's totally, you know, heretical for someone who's on a corporate board, but, you know, we spend a lot of time talking about share buybacks. You know, share buybacks were illegal. Share buybacks before 1982, when the SEC changed the rule, was considered stock manipulation. For companies to actually buy their shares back, it was considered manipulative. Okay, the rule changed. We designed that into the system. And so now, surprise, we all focus, sit around a corporate board table.
Talking about shared buybacks.
What do you think? And who's really, really benefiting from that? Workers aren't benefiting from that because workers don't actually own their companies anymore. Workers, we designed out of the system the profit sharing, I mean, the things that my grandfather, who was a porter at an oil company in Texas, but because the system was designed in the 1950s when he got a job there, he actually got stock
company
in
stock.
The company.
Wow.
It was designed that way.
So we're example today is
and
a porter
and
stock.
My grandmother, to this day, at age 94, she has her little check of you know, that Anadarko, which is now the company that two generations of companies of acquisitions later, but if she has her little Anadarko stock. And, you know, but that was designed out of the system. And so there are things that we actually know generate the results that we're getting today. Mm-hmm. And we could design a different system if we wanted to.
What would you say to individuals that say, maybe they're working at whatever organization, bank, wherever it may be, and they also want to do something meaningful, but they've got to pay the bills and everything else, but they've got this deep tug to do, as you say, something meaningful.
Well, I think, first of all, it's really important that we have good people working in the corporate sector. So I don't think that everyone should go and work for a nonprofit because I think the ability to bring empathy and a social consciousness to all facets of our society is needed more than ever. I do think, though, that for some people, the pull and the tension from doing work that on days doesn't feel gratifying has to lead one to think about how do you bring your vocation, what you've been trained to do, what you do, can you bring that closer to an avocation? Mm-hmm. You know, how do you bring those two things together? I'm very lucky because it's completely the same. But my situation is rare and I don't hold it out as a normative thing. I think most people get up every day, go to work, you know, at a bank or an insurance company or whatever, but they're concerned about the growing homelessness in their community, or they're concerned about the criminal justice system, or about young people not having educational opportunity, and feel like they want to make a difference. And you can make a difference. And it's important to not think about, to think about making a difference one person at a time. You know, institutions like Ford, we think about scale, because we should. thinking about scale. But individuals, the ability to change one child's life or one family's trajectory is the work of a lifetime.
Yeah.
I mean, and so it doesn't mean that you've got to go and leave your job and go and work, you know, for the United Way. I mean, it means that you volunteer, you join a board, you find an organization that you go deep on, and you bring your skill set.
Darren, thank you very, very much.
Thank you. It's such a treat. Thank you all for coming.